been preaching on the idea of what it means to be Trinitarian, to worship and serve the triune God, God in three persons, God creator, God incarnate through the presence of Jesus the Christ, and God Spirit, the Holy Spirit. The first part, we look at Genesis 1 and John 1. We share that John, of all the disciples, was a phenomenal theologian and was one who really wrestled with understanding who God is. And last week, we looked at another aspect of John, John 14. We wrestled with that for a little bit. Today, we want to wrestle with John 3, and we want to conclude with the very well-known passage, John 3, 16 and 17. And we want to put this into context for today. If you have your analog Bibles with you, please go and turn to John 3, 1 to 17. If you have your digital Bibles with you, go and fire that up, find the scripture, and let it power down so that we can set the context for this passage. If you have been watching the news, as I have, we find that we are in a season where many folks are losing hope, where there are so many in despair and in distress that it seems like those who have it going on have even lost their hope. It seems as if those who are doing all the things that society tells you to do, trains you to do, and socializes you to do, have been losing their way. Whether they are superstar millionaires who are building empires, whether they are people, everyday people who are losing hope because of the loss of job, the loss of family, people are losing their way. And I want to challenge all of us to know that a kind and gentle word on the right day and the right way to the right person can save somebody's life. I want to say it again that a gentle word, a kind word, a word of affirmation, a word of praise, a word of blessing to the right person in the right way. If the superstars are taking their own lives, then it must be things that are absolutely bad for a whole lot of people. And your ability to muster up the strength and the courage to say a good word, a kind word to someone, whether you know what they're going through or not, can be the very differential in whether they choose to live or choose not to. This is one of the things that Jesus taught us. It seems to have been buried so deep in the Word that we forget it. We seem to think that Jesus was teaching us how to live pious lives, how to live lives so that we are doing the best that we can. But somewhere in there, we lose the message that Jesus said that you all should be with one another, that you should pray for one another, that you should spend time with one another, that you should be your brother's and your sister's keeper. Somewhere along the way, that Jesus challenges us to be in community, to build community, and to be the community. Somehow we've thought that it's all about us and Jesus. As long as I got Jesus, I don't need nobody else. It's a good song, I like to sing it. But it may be inappropriate in a way where the system at hand, that God created all of the universe, and God created all of humanity, because God blesses each of us through one another. It's the presence of one another incarnate that helps us to be part of our healing, that helps us to be part of our hope. When you see someone you love doing well, there's just a sense of uplift in there. When somebody in your neighborhood seems to have got the come up, as we say, then it reveals that Jesus, that God, the Holy Spirit, is still blessing. And yet, he would have a peace. they're going to get that out one day. Nicodemus can pull Jesus aside and say, hey, there are a couple things that you said that have me pondering, have me wondering. I love this about Jesus because Jesus could reach those who are low and meek and mild, but he could also reach those who are the most learned and most educated. Jesus was just a common, regular, everyday dude with an extraordinary ministry called for by a phenomenal God to love everybody. Let's read this. John 3, 1 through 17. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one else can do the signs that you do unless God is with him. Jesus answered him, truly, truly I say, to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, truly, truly I say to you, unless one is born of water and spirit, he or she cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the spirit. Now Nicodemus said, yeah, how can these things be? Jesus said, are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things for real? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved. Thus, Jesus is saying, through me, through me. A couple of things I want to share with you in this passage. In the very beginning of the passage, Nicodemus finds Jesus in the middle of the night. Clearly, he does not want to be seen by his colleagues, by his peers. Clearly, he does not want to be scolded as the teacher of all Israel, seeking knowledge and wisdom by Jesus, a common seminary. Notice that not only does he find him at night, but he identifies him as Rabbi, which means the teacher. So here the teacher calls Jesus the teacher. There's a humility there. There's a sense of understanding that this truly is God incarnate. There is no way in the world that he can do what he does if he is not with God or of God. So there's an absolute respect and humility in the posturing of Nicodemus to Jesus. Nicodemus is on a tipping point because what he has believed all of his adult life is coming into question right now. His whole stability as a teacher of Israel is coming unstable. He's realizing that what he has prophesied and what he has pontificated and what he has taught for so long may not be true. I don't know if you've ever been in a place where you've been telling untruths as truths, and it's about time that you get called out. I don't know if you've been in a great debate.
Through the soul-saving grace of Christ, and be
hear it, and you feel it, and you know it's there, but you don't know from whence it comes. And he's saying you need to be okay with that. We need to be okay with the fact that God promises to never to leave us nor forsake.
Not the story that hates, needs, and knows. Thank God for the Holy Spirit who is with us each and every day, whispering in our ear, in our consciousness, in our hearts, reminding us that God is able to do abundantly and exceedingly more than we could ever imagine. Remind us that the only thing that God can do is fail. And if there's no failure in God, guess what, God's creation? There's no failure in Him. So we got to reprogram our minds and reprogram our hearts. That you are a child of the Most High. You are a special, valuable, privileged entity that God specifically created. Knew the number of hairs on your head before you even came out of your mother's womb. God meticulously chiseled and refined and just coiled everything together so that you could exist. God loves you so much that there's no room or planet in the universe of the galaxy just for you. You are a one of a kind. You are the only you that exists. And when we learn to love that you, there's a whole world that opens up. A whole system of possibilities that opens up. And the more to be the light. I pray that you accept God's grandchild.